Well, good morning, church. You guys sound angelic. You guys sound incredible. Man, it is so good to be here and worship God with you this morning. Amen. I'm so grateful to be with you guys. Well, we're going to be going over an amazing topic today. You know, who's ever heard of, the topic of love? Right? Who's ever heard of love? Love's a very, very powerful thing, right? Love's incredible. Now, let's get some thoughts from the audience. Now, if you were to describe love in one word, what could it be? What would you say love is? Brenda? God. All right, well, that ends it. Well, that ends the quest of every other answer. Okay. All right, DaCosta. Sacrificing. Yeah, Daddy. Forgiving. Okay. Dez. Selflessness. Okay. Levi. Choice. Okay. Adrian. Devotion. Okay. Richard. You had it. Patience. Okay. Martha. Is that what you were going to say? Amen. Okay. Wills. Unconditional. Joe. It's a verb. Amen. We'll end on that one. Amen. Love is a verb. Amen. That's awesome. Come on, bro. Amen. Well, who can tell me the soonest holiday that's coming up around the corner? Valentine's Day, right? Valentine's Day. I mean, you know, we've all heard the song, Cupid Shuffle, right? Cupid Shuffle. Cupid Shuffle. Who knows the Cupid Shuffle? Down, down, do your thing, do your thing. You know, that's a good jam right there. Cupid gets some people on Valentine's Day. You know, it's an amazing holiday. You know, but Valentine's Day, we want to think about it. So if God is love, right, and we are Christians, then Jesus is our Valentine, amen? Jesus is our Valentine, amen? You know, I think about my beautiful fiance. A year ago on Valentine's Day, we were dating at the time, but since then our love has grown, amen, right there. It's prospered, you know. But she gave me an amazing gift on Valentine's Day. For those of you who maybe don't know, I like coffee. I really like coffee. It's a very encouraging thing for me. But I like a lot of coffee. And so I also like coffee mugs. I was even at the brother's household last night at Jordan's house, and I kindly took one of their mugs. I didn't steal it. I mean, it was, Bible says we share all things, you know what I mean? So I was like, man, this is a cool mug. You guys don't need this, you know? So I go ahead and take it. But a year ago, she actually gave me an incredible gift. She gave me this amazing mug right here that says, "Love is the greatest adventure." Isn't that amazing right there? And if you notice, it's a little bit larger than a regular size mug because I like a lot of coffee, right? So it's a little bit larger. And you know what? I've used this cup almost every day for almost a year now, you know, almost every day. So whether it's, you know, like you look at those big cups for water, a bunch of ice cubes. It's great for when you're, you know, dehydrated. Or you're like, man, today's going to be a big day. Got to fill this whole thing up with coffee. But it says something powerful. It says, love is the greatest adventure. Think about that. Love is the greatest adventure. There are many, many adventures out there that are awesome, that are good, but they're not the greatest. Love is the greatest adventure. And if love is an adventure, we're going to be able to ride that roller coaster and that adventure this morning, amen? So if love's an adventure, you got to think about it like this, that you got to be in love to want to go on an adventure, right? And yet you got to be on an adventure to go find your love. Right, you gotta. It's an adventure to find your love, and when you're in love, it's an adventure to live life. Amen. So if we're gonna live this life, if this is gonna be an adventure, and Jesus is our Valentine, then the title of this morning's lesson is the guideline to your Valentine. Amen. The guideline to your Valentine. Turn your Bibles here to 1 Corinthians, chapter 13, and we'll be camping out right here in this scripture today. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So I'm going to give you guys some points on how to have the ideal date, okay? So how to have the ideal date. So the first thing you got to do in a date is point number one, validate your dinner reservation. Amen? You got to validate your dinner reservation. Now let's get a show of hands. I mean, we all want to go to the great banquet in heaven, right? But you got to validate that you actually have a seat saved for you. Are you with me right here? And yet, what's it going to take for you to get that validation? It's you got to answer the sub point, what is love? What is love? And Paul's going to explain it very thoroughly here in the scriptures. Paul's speaking to the church in Corinth at a time where there was works, a lot of works being done, a lot of people being converted, a lot of miracles being done, but the heart behind it is what he's encouraging them with right here. He said, man, I see a church working hard, just like the South region. I see the church working hard, right? I see the faith. I see the miracles being done, but I want to make sure that the heart of love is there. And that's truly the heart that the South has this morning. You with me right here? 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul writes in verse 1, he says, and now I will show you the most excellent way. Okay, so we'll stop right there before we go in. So he says, whatever he's about to say here is going to be the most excellent way. It's going to be the greatest adventure. Like, there's good adventures, there's good ways, but we don't want to follow the mediocre way. I mean, we don't want to follow the most easy way, right? We want to follow the most excellent way, right? Because later in chapter 14, he says, everything should be done in a fittingly and orderly way. You with me right here? God is a God of order. And so he says, hey, we're going to show you the most excellent way. So I'd be fired up right here. I'm like, man, this is going to be the most excellent way. What is he about to say? So he explains in verse 1, he says, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clinging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and cannot fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that I can move a mountain, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Wow. This is the most excellent way. I was like, I mean, what's the way so far? So far, I feel a little bit confused. I'm like, man, that means like everything I do, if I don't do it with love, it's in vain. Is it wrong? And interestingly, people think that, oh, he's just teaching the disciples how to love. No, they very well knew how to love. What he's doing is he's making a reference in distinguishing themselves from among the other people. He says in verse 1, if I speak in tongues of men and angels but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clinging cymbal. So a resounding gong. He's actually referencing right here to what people would do in idol worship. So people would smack gongs, and it'd be a resounding sound in the process in the middle of worshiping an idol. So he's saying, what he says, if I'm in the middle of miraculous gifts, I don't have love, I'm just a resounding gong. The purpose of miraculous gifts, according to chapter 14, 22, was only to get the Gentiles to believe. To speak in tongues was just speaking languages just to get people to believe. Just to get people to believe in God. Now, according to chapter 13, it later says all those will cease and they don't exist today. If you're visiting with us and that's news to you, I would encourage you to study the Bible and find out the real facts. Amen? But what he's saying is if I'm in the process of converting someone, but I don't have love, I'm no longer and no greater than the denominational world. I'm no greater than the people who worship idols. You think about a resounding gong. It becomes so much so that you hear it so often that it's just numbing your ears. Or he says, a clinging cymbal. You ever seen those like tiny little cymbals, like ching, you know, ching, ching? You know, that was my instrument in music class in third grade. I was like, can't play piano, can't play guitar. Give me the little clanging cymbals. That was my favorite thing. I was in the back, ching, 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 ching. You know what I mean? But what's the purpose is that if you're in an orchestra and I'm in the back clanging chings right there, clanging little cymbals, no one's really going to hear me. And so he's saying, if you're trying to convert people, if you're trying to do anything without love, no one's really going to have to listen to what you have to say. Are you with me right here? So the heart of love, and that's truly what the heart has in the South region, is we have a heart of speaking grace. Isn't that amazing? I love speaking in the fellowship. Even just the fellowship right there was so full of love. People in each other's lives, asking each other's questions. I mean, we're really wrapping our arms around people. And that's the most encouraging thing, is speaking this kind of love. He goes on to say, in verse 4, he's going to go and explain what love is. So what is love? You got to validate your dinner reservation, amen? What is love? Verse 4, he explains it. He says, love is patient. Oh, man, okay. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It isn't prideful and proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Wow. This is convicting already. I'm like, I thought I knew what love was, and I'm looking at this, and it's like, love is patient. Dang, I'm not patient at all. I'm like, love is kind. Whew, okay, all right, maybe some of these will describe me. It does not envy. I'm so envious. What the heck, all the time. It does not boast. I'm always trying to share about what the good things I've done. It's not pride. That's my core sin, is I'm prideful. What the heck? It's not rude. Man, I feel like being rude because I'm like not loving. You know what I mean? And it says, it's not self-seeking. I'm always seeking after myself for ambition. It's not easily angered. I'm getting angry right now. It keeps no record of wrongs. What the heck? I got a record of wrongs of all the times I've not loved. I'm keeping a record of wrongs against myself. Oh my gosh, this is super convicting right here. What is love? That's the question we got to answer this morning. What is love? You know, the Bible says in 1 John that God is love. God is love. You can substitute God's name for every single characteristic right here. God is patient. God is kind. God doesn't envy. God doesn't boast. God's not prideful. God's not rude. God's not self-seeking. Believe it or not, God's not easily angered. God keeps no record of wrongs. You know, that surely refutes a lot of my thoughts. For sure, I grew up learning that God has a detailed book of all the sins I've ever committed. I'm like, man, I do not want to see that movie screen playing. Like, when I go to judgment, and he says, all right, Caleb, we're going to watch on this big screen your playlist of sin your whole life. According to Isaiah, he says he remembers our sins no more. When instead he chooses to put at the forefront of his mind the sacrifice of his son, Jesus, that took your place of that sin. Isn't that amazing? And yet the Bible is calling out all these things. I'm like, man, what is love? And the first thing it says is love is patient. You know, in the Greek, patient means long-suffering. Isn't that awesome right there? Long-suffering. Suffering for a long time. You know, I think it's hard to understand where it's easy to love people, right, when it's easy. But it's hard to love people when it's hard. Love is very difficult. And it says first thing love is patient. So we do not love people because we're patient. We're patient because we love people. Isn't that awesome? It's that I don't have the strength of patience. So if I'm patient, it's because I really love you. If I'm kind, I really love you. If I'm not envious, I really love you. I might be a little bit jealous, but I'll love you. But the Bible says, man, love, we are able to love because we're not these things. If we were these things, we wouldn't be able to love because we'd be Jesus. We'd be God. God is these things. And yet, as imitators of Christ, we can be these. Now, the first thing it says, love is patient. You know, I think about just how patient God is, how patient God's timing is. You know, my father, for those of you who don't know, my father was adopted, and he grew up, and he grew up with an adopted family, but there was a couple points in his life where he tried searching for his dad and his mom. He tried searching for his dad. He tried searching for his dad a couple times. He's never even seen a picture of his dad. Never even spoken to his dad. He doesn't even know what he could possibly look like. Searching for his dad, still hasn't found him to this day. He's searching for his mom, my grandma. And in his mid-30s, there came about a facility called, it was called the International Finder Society. So they'd be able to find people internationally for you and put brothers and brothers together and sisters and family members together. So he calls the International Finding Society, and he's looking up, and they have an updated list every couple years. And so he's looking for his mom. Turns out she had just moved right before he looked, so he just missed her. Like her information was invalid, so they didn't have her updated address or updated information. Turns out a couple months later, she looks for him, but he just moved, and she barely missed him. This goes on for years. And the entire time, my dad is still questioning, do my parents even love me? She gave birth to him when she was 16, my grandma, when she was 16. He was 37 years old when he got a call one day. He got a call from the International Finder Society, and they said, do you want to meet your mom? He said, yes. It was almost surreal in that moment. Of course I want to meet her, but am I going to, or what? And they said, we found your mom. We want to fly you out to New York City and put you on the Sally Jesse Show and tell the story of what happened. So they fly him all the way out to New York City. At this point, he's still thinking it's a prank. He's like, is this real life? I mean, I've never met my mom. I've never seen a picture of my mom. She's never spoken to me. I don't know what she looks like. I don't know how tall she is. I don't know anything. And so what they did is they put him in the audience of the show. And he's sitting there, and you could just imagine feeling that. Before the show starts, you're sitting in anxiety because you're about to see your mom for the first time. It's been 37 years. She was 53 at that point. 37 years, all coming up to this very moment. The show starts, Sally Jesse starts to speak. And my dad, I'll never forget what he said to me. He said, they called out, my grandma's name's Cindy. They called out Cindy. And he said, I'd never seen my mom in my entire life. But as soon as she walked out, I knew that was my mom. I knew that was my mom. I said, that's my mom. And he'd actually planned it out with the directors before the show started, that in the middle of the show, in the middle of the show, that he would be able to raise his hand and ask a question. And so little does she know, though, but she has no idea he's here. She was literally going on the show. They convinced her to go on the show to plead for help. So he's in on it, but she has no idea. She's like, man, she has no idea he's on. She gets on the show in the middle of the show, and she's saying, I made a huge mistake when I was 16. I should have never given him up. I should have never given him up. I should. And she's bawling, crying, to the point where she's humiliating herself, pleading now to the public world to finally find her son. And my dad had planned out a something with the directors before to say where he was going to raise his hand. And he raised his hand in the middle of the talk show and says, hey, I got something to say. And usually that's like unheard of. You don't take comments from the, you know what I mean, from the audience. And she kindly, Sally Jesse, looks at my grandmother and says, you know, hey, somebody has a question. And he stands up and he says, you know, ma'am, I commend you for what you did. Being 16 years old, you didn't have to carry that baby. You went through a lot. And I myself am adopted, and I've never met my mom and dad. And I want to encourage you because I've always wanted to tell my mom that I loved her. So I think I'll take that opportunity right now. And he grabs some flowers. Music starts, and he walks up on the stage. And they embrace, and they cry in tears. And it was such a moment. I mean, it's on this old VHS tape, amen? And it was so crazy because you could see in the video, she stands up, and she's shocked. And it was a moment of son and a reassurance of mom. And they hugged, and they embraced. And now she's a part of my life, and they communicate almost every week. And I visit their family almost every year, and my dad found his mom. Amen? Pretty cranking. But you think about that my dad was so patient for 37 years that the technology was not available to find his mom. I can imagine the guilt she would have felt. And yet, that's the kind of heart God has. You know, the Bible says that to a day is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day to the Lord. How many years did it take you to become a Christian? Think about that. How many years has it taken to get you to this very moment where there's been something in your life that you haven't changed your entire life? And he's waited 15, 20, 30, 40 years for you to come to this very moment. He's been that patient. Where a day, it could be 1,000 years. So you think about how many years it's been. 365 days, that's 365 years, times however old you are. That's how long it could feel because of just how much he wants to see you grow. Or 1,000 years could be a day to the Lord. That even when you turn 1,000 years old, because of his love for you, because of his patience for you, it could feel just like a day. You know, it says the same story. And I believe that in Genesis 29, Jacob had the same heart. It says that Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days because of his love for her. Isn't that amazing? That's truly Valentine's Day. You got to validate your dinner reservation. You know, my challenge for you guys is simple. I want to walk out with some encouragement, amen? So my challenge is simple. Encourage 5 people about what you love about them before you leave service. Tell 5 people and make sure you get 5 people to tell you. You know what I mean? If you're walking out and you only got 3 people that have come and confirmed with you what they love about you, make sure you go find another couple too, amen? Like, hey, can you tell me what you love about me? You know what I mean? Hey, I don't think you love me, man. Tell me. You know what I mean? No, I'm just kidding. We all know each other's love, amen? But love is so patient, guys. Let's go on to verse 6. And we'll go to our second point. In order to have an amazing date, yes, you need to validate your dinner reservation. But my second point is you got to order from the menu. You got to order from the menu. Amen. I mean, it'd be kind of weird if I were to go to 7-Eleven and say, hey, where's the caviar? Hey, where's the, can I have a, I'll have two margaritas with two bendy straws, please. That would be really weird, you know what I mean? That'd be kind of weird. Are you with me right here? If I go to McDonald's and say, hey, we'll have two T-bone steaks, medium rare, please. That would, I'm sorry, sir, this is McDonald's. We realize you're on a budget, so we know we don't serve T-bone steaks because those are a bit more expensive than what you're actually here for, amen? It'd be kind of weird if I did that, right? And I mean, you got to order from what's on the menu. And according to Scripture, God has a menu. And even your own life, you have a menu. And it's blank. God writes on it. You know what God ordered from your menu? If we're going to talk about love today, 1 John 5:3 says, God feels loved through obedience of his commands. Isn't that amazing? So God ordered obedience from your menu this morning. God's been ordering obedience. And you know what? He's so patient to finally bring you here today to the point where you can make the decision to give God what he ordered this entire time. In verse 6, it says, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It's very simple, sweet, and it's just like a clean sentence right there, right? No commas, no quotations. It's like, man, love does not delight in evil, rejoices with the truth. Pretty incredible. You know, I looked up the Greek on this, and I can't quite pronounce the Greek word, but give me some grace here. Autathia is the Greek word right there for truth, which means fulfillment from sound doctrine amongst false teachers. Isn't that amazing? So the Bible says, love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It can be translated in Greek to the fulfillment from sound doctrine amongst false teachers. Wow. That true love has nothing to do with evil. There's such a cheap grace in the world today. That Paul in the beginning of the scripture right here is explaining, hey, I'm not going to be an idol worshiper and try to convert you without love. You see, it's very simple. He's basically saying, you can't give people what you yourselves don't have. And I want to encourage you, if you're visiting with us, if you're regularly a part of a denominational church, or if you haven't been to church in a while, or whatever it may be, I want to encourage you. The world offers a cheap grace. The world offers a love that it delights in evil. It delights in evil. It delights in amongst false teachers. The Bible goes on to say in 2 Timothy 4 that people will leave and abandon the truth to go to teachers who will tell them what their itching ears want to hear. That's not loving. I say this. The only thing worse than dying an atheist is dying deceived into thinking you were saved. That's the only thing worse. I'd rather die an atheist than die deceived. I was thinking I was saved. Show up on judgment and say, I was convinced I had salvation. My church told me that all I had to do was believe. My church told me that if I went to the altar and prayed a prayer, I'd be just fine. I would encourage you, you got to order salvation from God's menu. I'd encourage you to study the Bible right here. Study the Bible. See what's in the menu. I mean, some of us order like, man, Burger King, have it my way. No, it's Jesus is King, have it his way. Are you with me right here? Amen. And if we want to say, okay, God, can I get some heaven? Yeah, you're going to have to obey my commands. Can I have a sight of encouragement? Yeah, you're going to have to be encouraging. Can I see the world evangelized? Yeah, you're going to have to sacrifice missions. There's a cost for everything you order off of God's menu. You know, I think back when I was a little boy, littler than I am now. Amen. I think back when I was a little boy, believe it or not, I used to have long, curly, blonde, bleach blonde hair. If I wasn't wearing the color blue, I looked like a girl. It's pretty encouraging. I get so ticked off. Talk about love is patient, you know? Love is not easily angered. Someone's like, oh, sweetie, how old are you? 4 and a half. Cut that hair right off, amen? But when I was a little kid, I think of my relationship with my father. And, you know, it's, I don't know what it is about being a kid. You're always so anxious to go to sleep. You know what I mean? You're like, I mean, I don't know, that was just me. I was like, I never wanted to go to bed when it was time to go to bed. Because 7:30 bedtime is not fun. You know what I mean? That's not cool. If I stayed up till like 8:30, I was like, oh, Craig, 8:30. I'm a big kid now. You know what I mean? Like, that was amazing. But I remember the only thing I liked about going to bed was my mom, but mainly my dad coming and saying goodnight to me. And there was a routine that my dad would do with me every night. My mom would come to me, and she would say goodnight to me, and she would scratch my head. She has these, like, long French nails. They're the best for a head massage, right? So she scratches my head and sings me to sleep, and she thinks I'm asleep, but I'm just, like, I'm closing my eyes and acting like I'm asleep so she can get out of there and my dad can come in. Because my dad and I had a really fun routine. And I'm just closing my eyes like, yeah, I'm asleep. And she goes, how are you sleeping if you're talking? And I was like, oh, yeah. You know, but the movies always show it, like people fall asleep like this on their back and then they wake up like this, which is totally false doctrine. I mean, nobody sleeps like that. I don't believe. I mean, I've never slept like that. Anyway, so I would fake sleep like that. And then I'd hear my mom leave, and that's when I would open my eyes, and I would wait in expectation for my dad to come in the room. My dad would come in the room, and the first thing I would act, and then I knew he heard him come in the room, and then I would act like I was asleep. You know, I'd act like I was asleep. And he goes, hey, is there a sleeping boy in here? I know someone's not asleep. Someone's not asleep. And then he would tickle fight me. He would just like get crazy tickle me, right? And I'd freak out and laugh, and we would talk, and he would talk with me goodnight. But he would always say this every night. He'd say, okay, go to sleep, son. Good night, son. And he wouldn't say, I love you. He'd say, good night, son. And I knew what he was doing. Yeah, I would sit there, okay, whew, do the false doctrine sleeping, you know, lay like this. And I'd be laying on my bed, and my door's back here, and I'd be laying on my bed, and the back of my bed was, you could see over it, but he would slightly crack my door. And I would wait till I heard him leave the room. And as soon as he left the room, I would turn over, you know, I'd get on my pillow and look, and there was a light blue baby blue nightlight in the hallway, bright enough to where I could see his body till the end of the hall. And I'd just wait there. I'd wait. And every night, he'd walk down the hall, and right at the edge, he would turn to me and speak to me from the side when he got to the end of the hall, and he would say, Daddy loves. And I would say, oh, you got it. Daddy loves. I'd say it back to him. But I wanted to make sure he heard it. I'm like, oh, maybe he didn't hear it. And I'd say it louder. I'd say, Daddy loves. You know, and then he'd repeat it back to me. He goes, Daddy loves. And I'd say, oh, okay, he heard me. Okay, whew. Yeah. And I would go back, and then I could sleep in peace. You know, God wants you to be reassured of his love every night before you go to bed. My dad, the next morning, would take me to school every day. I couldn't tell you how many times my dad did this. And he would tell me, he said, son, and he would get tears in his eyes. He said, son, I get tears in my eyes just thinking about you. And he loved me so much. And he'd take my little blonde curly head by the face, my little girl face, my little girly, godly face, amen. God created it, amen. Take my little face. And he would always, I knew that he wanted to really get a point across if we touched foreheads. And so he touched my forehead, you know. We touched foreheads. And he looks at me in the eyes. And he looks at me and he says, son, I never want you to ever question how much I love you. You know how much I love you, son? You know how much I love you? I said, yeah, I know, Dad. I know. And I would be almost uncomfortable in those moments. Like, yeah, I know, Dad. My friends are watching. You know what I mean? I know, Dad. But he reassured me every single day. He said, son, and he would almost let me leave the car with in tears in his eyes. Because he never wanted me to feel the way he felt growing up. He never wanted me to feel the insecure thought, am I loved? No matter what game my dad missed, you know, no matter what happened in my dad's life, no matter if he was short and he couldn't pay for my new cleats, he couldn't pay for me to get a haircut of my girly little hair. I mean, no matter what he did, I never questioned his love. And yet God wants to reassure you in the same way this morning. That every night before you go to bed, I would encourage you, let the scriptures teach you in Psalm 4, verse 8, he says, I will sleep down in peace because you alone, Lord, give me rest. You alone, I find contentment. God whispers, I love you to you every night. I would encourage you to pray before you go to bed and say, I love you, Dad. You don't have to say, Daddy loves, I mean, but I love you, Dad. It's so important to fall asleep with security. I got to ask you, if you're visiting, what's it like when you go to sleep at night? What's it like when you lay your head on the pillow, all smiles are gone, all friends are gone, nothing you did today matters, no one's with you. What do you have? Do you have the reassurance of God's love? For disciples, when you go home, you must find reassurement you must be reassured by your relationship with God. That you don't come here and put on a show. The South is a true family here. We don't come here and put on a show. We come here and tell people exactly where we're at. We tell people, this is what's going on in my life. This is what I'm tempted with. This is how I feel. This is how much it's going to cost me to sacrifice for missions. This is my plan to do it. This is my heart. Here it is. The South is so known for giving each other the hearts. And I want to encourage you, if you're visiting, get yourself in that kind of family. That it's so hard because there was a point in time where my innocence as a kid was ripped away from me. That I was no longer waiting for a daddy loves. I was waiting for a bottle to put me to sleep. I was waiting for a girl to sleep with me in bed. I was waiting for an opportunity to rob a house, which I would go on to do all those things. Where my reassurance was no longer in God and no longer in the love of my Father, but it was in the things of this world. I got to ask you, what puts you to sleep at night? What puts you to sleep at night? Do you have to be distracted? You got to play music? You got to scroll through Facebook until you get tired? Or can you go to sleep in peace? Every disciple can go to sleep in peace. Because God ordered obedience from your menu, and the day you got baptized is when you gave it to him. You with me right here? And today, our soon-to-be brother Ryan is going to give God what he wants from his menu. Amen? Come on, bro. Let's go to our third and final point. My challenge for you is simple on that point. Is set up 3 Bible studies this week. 3 personal Bible studies this week. If you're a disciple, set up 3 personal Bible studies. We've got to have our love for the lost. There's so many people that cry themselves to sleep, that sin themselves to sleep. But that's not us. We reassure ourselves to sleep. For the visiting, I want to inspire you to imitate our soon-to-be brother's Ryan's faith right here. Study the Bible every single day this week to get right with God by Sunday. If you're not a disciple of Jesus Christ, if you have not given God the obedience he ordered from your menu since the day you were born, what does that mean? That you have had full faith, you fully repented, according to Acts 2, and you've gotten baptized for the forgiveness of your sins and received the Holy Spirit. According to that scripture, Romans 6 says you're submerged in the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus saves you. Colossians 2 says your faith resurrects you from that baptism, and that's the point of salvation. I would encourage you, if you think anything else, you're flat wrong. That's not on God's menu. That's not on God's menu. If you believe that, study the scriptures today. It's not an option to show up to judgment and found out you never had your reservation validated because you ordered from the wrong menu. You called Domino's and went to go pick up at Subway. And God's like, man, I don't work there, man. I don't work at any of those places. I don't know what you were doing. I do not work at Subway. God doesn't work at Subway, although his scriptures are fresh. Are you with me? Amen. My third point for you this morning is when you're on an awesome date with your Valentine Jesus, you got to wait for the check. You got to wait for the check. It costs something. The check is going to cost something. Let's go here to verse 7, and we'll close out. The Bible says that Love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails. Never. People say, I don't know what to do. I just can't seem to get it done. I feel like I'm failing. Have you tried to love? Tried love? Like, yeah, I tried love. I mean, do you know what is love? Because otherwise, baby, don't hurt me. I mean, if you don't know what love is, I mean, you got to study the Bible. Are you with me right here? But love never fails. According to the scripture, it says it always protects. You know, this is actually, the Greek is referencing to 1 Peter 4:8 when he says love covers over a multitude of sins. Isn't that amazing? He says it always protects. The Greek means to cover with silence. So protecting people is more than physical. It's protecting their dignity as well. That I got to put before you, gossip is a salvation issue. Sharing people's sin is a salvation issue. Sharing people's business is a salvation issue. Many people put themselves to sleep with gossip because they scroll through Facebook, scroll through Twitter, look on Instagram, looking at the trash of the world. No. Love protects. It guards. In fact, there are things you've done in your life that God loves you so much that he's protected the world from knowing them. So you aren't up to public humiliation. He's protected you. Interestingly, he says he always trusts. The Greek right here means to have a saving faith. That's the Greek word for trust, is a saving faith. You have so much faith, so much trust, that very faith is the same faith that saves you at, Colossians 2, baptism. That faith will save you. And that's what true love is. It's the same saving faith. Love is faithful. It takes a lot of faith to have deep love. He says it always hopes. You know, the Greek word for hope right here means to wait with joy and full confidence. Waiting with joy. I mean, hope is not like, it might happen. No, according to this scripture, it says when you have a deep heart of love and you're hoping, that means that you're waiting joyfully and full of confidence. Like, I know what's going to happen. I know what's going to happen. I know you can change. I know this miracle can be done. And truly, miracles are being done, guys. This is the hope we had. You know, I put before you that we had a plan called the Crown of Thorns Project that we all hoped would get done. We said, man, we're going to plant a church in Santiago, Chile, in London, Sao Paulo, in Mexico, in Paris, in Sydney, Australia, in Chennai, India, in Moscow, Russia, Manila, Philippines, Lagos, Nigeria, Dubai. I sure hope it happens. I sure hope so. Man, I don't even know how to spell Chennai. Like, what the heck? How can I send people there? He says, man, a deep love, though, can accomplish it because you have full confidence that it's going to get done. You know, I stand before you that if I stood before you, and I'm calling out a lot of pastors right now, I'm calling out a lot of false doctrine and a lot of denominational theology, that I put before you I'm a Pharisee, and I put before you that I am a false teacher if I don't have a plan to back it up. Otherwise, I'm just like Jude. I'm a fault finder that can't solve the issue. I'm just a fault finder to say, yeah, these guys preach this and it's wrong. These guys preach this and it's wrong. These guys preach this and it's wrong. You know, authors do that. They write books critiquing other people's books. That's easy. No. I'm going to call it out, but back it up, because we have a plan to evangelize the world. And in 2017, this summer, we're going to plant our last pillar church in Hong Kong, China. Does that fire you up? We really have a plan. We have more than just a plan. Because these places are without God. You say, yeah, we've sent mission trips there. I've actually been a part of churches that have sent a mission trip there. I knew of a place that, hey, they built a house in Mexico City. Yeah, they went and built a house, but it wasn't God's house. I mean, according to scripture right here, they went and clanged a gong and chimed some cymbals together. But without love, the gospel's not really there. So we have more than a plan to just say that we planted pillar churches in all continents. We have the second plan, which is called Operation Eagle. This is the plan to evangelize the entire United States. I put before you, go to a handful of churches, and I would just look it up. Maybe look up the directory and call the pastor and say, do you believe in world evangelism? He says, of course I do. Then why aren't you doing it? You're not a church. You're a social club. It should tick you off. You don't delight in evil. It should tick you off that there's false doctrines on Sunday morning that people are coming and hearing itching teachings to their ears. It should tick you off. Say, hey, we got a plan. I don't know if you know this, Pastor Bob, but we have a plan. Do you want to get unified with it? We're going to unveil a plan at midweek to reach the denominational world. We're going to go into all these states and say, listen, you believe in world evangelism? That's awesome. Well, we really believe in world evangelism because faith, because James chapter 2 says your faith will be accompanied by your deeds. Without the deeds, your faith is dead. And so we have that kind of faith that we're backing up. We're putting our money where our mouth is. And we want to evangelize the world. We're going to sacrifice to evangelize the world, and we will evangelize the world in this generation. Are you with me, church? We have a need in the kingdom of God. We have 25 times special missions contribution. And that need is so severe that there's so many things, there's so many broken things out there that you need to wait for the check. It's easy to want to dine and dash, to want to come into service, get what you need, and leave before you really pay. Not everyone has your salvation. Not everyone has the friendships you have. Not everyone has the love that you guys share, the family we have, just the unity we're able to have. And that's what our sacrifice is that we put our money where our mouth is we say, man, our money means nothing to us because it's going to burn someday. To evangelize the world, it's going to take two things. It's going to take money and it's going to take people. And there's a need in the kingdom of God that we are supposed to raise 25 times our regular weekly contribution as a church for a whole region right here. And that's a big number right there. I stutter because it's like a lot of money. You know what I mean? Are you with me right here? To think, man, okay, we got to come up with $14,000 by the end of this month. I put before you that God's people step up to the plate. When there is a need in the kingdom of God, the people of God, the family of God, step up and meet that need. And it is the job of the preacher to call the people to meet the needs of God. Are you with me right here? We have a need. It's not optional. That people really need this money. People really need this heart. People don't have what we have. You know, I got to celebrate. We got Valentine's Day coming up. Someone told me it was Valentine's Day. And I was like, really? It's Valentine's? Shoot, I got to get a present. No, I'm just kidding. Got to get a present. Dang it. I'm behind. But no, I mean, I for me, I'm so, I struggle so much with being ahead of the game and being on top of things that I usually buy my presents for people sporadically throughout the year. So I've had Liz's Valentine's Day gifts for about 6 months now. Hopefully they're still, they don't haven't expired. No, I'm just kidding. Now those box of chocolates are getting a little dusty. No, I'm just kidding. But you know what's amazing is we actually had our first marriage counseling session this last Saturday, amen. That was pretty encouraging, amen. Marriage counseling's really amazing. It's I learned a lot. I mean, I thought I knew what marriage was. I walked out, I was like, same kind of question as my first point. What is marriage? Shoot, I put a ring on it, and I don't even know what I'm doing. I mean, like, whoa. I was like, I don't know what marriage is. Because I saw it in the scriptures. I looked at the menu, and I was like, that's what's on the menu for marriage? I didn't order that. I was like, I did not order that. Whoa, okay. I mean, we were both in for a surprise. You know, in Malachi, it says that the purpose of marriage is that God wants godly offspring. I was like, what the heck? I wasn't planning on having kids ASAP. You know what I mean? I was like, whoa, I did not think marriage was that. But it was so reassuring to know that, to think about that. And you know, the patience God has is that the relationship with God we have is like a marriage. It's a commitment. It's a faithfulness to one. And I remember almost three. I've known Liz over 3 years now. We've been dating for over two. Engaged for almost a month. Actually, we have been engaged for over a month now. That's awesome. But I think back to before I even knew if Liz liked me, months before we even dated, we had the Global Leadership Conference where all the churches around the world, because we're an international church, amen, all the churches around the world came to this conference in Palm Springs. It was screaming hot. I mean, we're dripping sweat. It was awesome. It was awesome. And, you know, not on my accord, but, you know, Liz asked me to the banquet date, you know. And I was like, I'll have to check my, yes, I will for sure go with you. I'm a baked potato in sweat right here. I'm like, man, this is, okay. She's for sure not going to like me after she sees that I'm a sweat monkey. I mean, like, my goodness. Okay, so we go on the date. It was pretty awesome. I'll say that. Pretty awesome. We had chicken and mashed potatoes that night. It was awesome. You were wearing a beautiful red dress with a black jacket. It was awesome. You know, your high heels were this. I'm just kidding. No. I know. I like details. Amen. Anyway, so after the date, I had this crazy thought. A thought came into my head. This before I even confirmed. Like we never told each other we liked each other. We weren't even leading a ministry. Like she was just a regular sister in the kingdom of God. A thought came into my head. You're gonna marry Liz. I was like, I gotta guard my heart. What am I thinking? Satan, get out of here! Like, what? Like, I'm gonna marry Liz? Like, I went on a banquet date. I just sweated my face off in front of this woman. Like, I was like, and I'm 18 years old. Like, what do you mean I'm gonna get married? But it kept ringing, like a resounding gong. And the gong stopped when I felt the love and it became real. I said, wow. I actually got open with somebody. I felt like I was insane. I was like, I gotta get open about this thought. You know what I mean? So I pulled aside Tyler Young's mom. He was my first discipler in Eugene. He's in the Sacramento church now. I pulled him aside. I was like, bro, I gotta be open here. You know, man, I don't know. I think you're gonna laugh at me here. And he goes, bro, just spit it out, dude. I was like, man, like, this is weird. But, you know Liz? He's like, yeah, I know Liz. I was like, yeah, you know Liz, man? I had this crazy thought, bro. I had a thought that, I don't know where it came from, but I think I'm gonna marry Liz. And he looked at me, and I mean, this was such great, he was so graceful with me. He looked at me and he says, it's not impossible. And yet, we stand here in 2017, the year of the impossible, and on June 24th, right here, we're going to get married. Amen. That was super cranking. Wow, and to think that we went to our first marriage counseling session, I looked at her and I was like, I sweated in front of you. I was like, you see me at my worst, you know what I mean? You still love me. And that's the family, is people can see you in your spiritually sweatiest times, and you can still get married to them. Nah, man, just kidding. You can still marry them. You know, you never know who you're gonna marry, amen? But I think about that, and I say, wow, what do I need to do? I said, if that's possible, then what else could I do? What else could the church do? We've done so much, guys. You know we've sent out about 100 leaders since the South started? 100 leaders. 100 leaders we've sent out. All around the world. That's totally possible. What would this room be like if they were still here? We'd be up in the second story. That this entire stadium fits 800 people. I put before you that there's just the first 5 rows filled up. That if my little sweaty thought can become reality with patience, with time, with great love, God can fill the end of the back of that row, the bend of the back of that row. God can fill us to where we will grow out of this stadium and we will meet in the Angel Stadium because the angels are on our side. Are you with me right here? The angels are with us, guys. Guys, we have a serious need. You got to turn in your 25% of your mission's goal by the end of this week. I challenge you to make it happen by the 29th. Make it happen. Turn in your 25%. Get what you got to do. Do whatever you got to do to get ahead on your missions. You know, I want to leave you guys with this. You know, I want to encourage you guys, as a small challenge, to write a poem over Valentine's card to God for Valentine's Day. write a Valentine's Day card to God. God, you're my Valentine. You're my ultimate Valentine. And you're really going to show up to the dinner date. You're not going to ditch me. Amen? He'll always be there early before we are. He's been there. Actually, he started the restaurant. So I have a letter for you guys I want to encourage you with about who God thinks you are, about who God sees you as today, about the kind of Valentine that you are to Jesus. You are a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. You have the Holy Spirit's power. You are disciples of His. You won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. Your past is redeemed. Your presence makes sense. Your future is secure. You are finished and done with low living, sight walking, smooth knees, careless dreams, tamed visions, worldly talking, cheap giving, and fake love. Your face is set. Your gate is fast. Your goal is heaven. Your road may be narrow. Your way rough. Your companions few. Your guide reliable. Your mission is clear. You cannot be bought, compromised, detoured, lured away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. You won't give up, shut up, let up until you've stayed up, stored up, prayed up, paid up, and preached up for the cause of Christ. You're a disciple of Jesus. You must go till He comes, give till you drop, preach till all of the world knows, and work till He stops you. And when He comes for His own, He will have no problem recognizing you, because your love will be clear, because you validated your reservation, you ordered from the menu, you waited for the check, because you followed the guideline to your Valentine, and to God be the glory.